I'm Rod Serling. You're listening to The Zero Hour. Rest your eyes. Exercise your imagination. This week, Adam Hall's chess match of continental intrigue. Queen in danger. Starring Juliet Mills. Robert Brown. And Murray Matheson. In Elliot Lewis's production of The Zero Hour.
Mutual Broadcasting System presents The Zero Hour. Sponsored in part by
the makers of Contact and Quaker State Motor Oil. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
It is a fact that in people's lives, things do go wrong. An unfortunate event or a personal tragedy of some sort. There's always something external, something unexpected. In a word, trouble. And there are those who thrive on it. Take, for example, Hugo Bishop. Trouble is his business and his pleasure. Maud London is his scene. And trouble is what he's about to find in the persons of Thelma Tasman, known professionally as Gloria Del Rey, Queen Bee of the fashion world, and her husband, Mervyn Spate, convicted murderer, declared legally mad, and for the past 2 years, a full-time tenant in a Broadmoor asylum for the criminally insane, where there has just been a daring escape. Hugo Bishop is in for a rare treat. Mervyn Spate is back in London. Our story, Queen in Danger, we'll begin after this word. Picture this. London, the first day of spring. The season newly arrived from Paris, overnight and traveling light, to drape green gossamer among skeleton twigs and blow a zephyrous breath against the royal standard high above Buckingham Palace. The Queen is at home. Fear has not yet entered the mind of the woman in green, walking briskly along the pathway in St. James Park. She'll be free of fear for another 5 minutes, perhaps six, but no more. She stops to buy a paper, folds it and tucks it under her arm and walks on. She turns now into Bond Street, and her shadow is cut off suddenly and silently by the high corner buildings, and she's accompanied instead by her glassy reflection in shop windows. Then that too is gone, as she passes the rubble of a bombed site, left abandoned since the Second World War. A grim reminder of how it was. But now, as she steps through the gilt and glass paneled entrance of the fashionable Salon des Fleurs, the woman in green moves unsuspectingly among the placid flower bowls in the heavy, perfumed air toward her destined appointment with sudden panic.
Good morning, Mrs. Tasman. I'll be with you in just a moment. I have Mrs. Carmody on the phone.
Yes, please. I'm in rather a rush.
Yes, Mrs. Carmody. I have it down. Tuesday week, 3 o'clock. I said Tuesday week, 3 o'clock. That will be fine, Mrs. Carmody.
I'm sorry. I came in to make an appointment, but could you fit me in tomorrow after lunch?
Oh, Would 4 o'clock be convenient?
If I can be out by 5.
Is it just for your usual face back, Mrs. Tasman?
Yes, that's all.
Well, you should be away by 5 then.
Thank you.
Oh, Mrs. Tasman?
Yes?
You left your newspaper.
Oh. I turned away toward the ordinary day outside, to the ghost of my reflection in the window. Beyond the glass, the cars and people in the street pass by like figures in a silent film. I felt distracted all the way to my office. I barely noticed the street traffic. I was overwhelmed by feelings of anxiety. I don't know what it was exactly. Guilt or fear? Once inside the Miller Group Publishers building, my sense of panic eased a little. My work was a necessary distraction. But the nameplate on the door to my private office reminded me who I was, or wasn't. Gloria Del Rey, fashion editor, Venus Magazine. Nom de plume for Thelma Tasman, which was, in turn, an assumed name. I left word with Glenda, my secretary, to hold all calls. I was summoned by my boss and trusted friend, Maurice Gerald.
Come in, Thelma.
I just saw the proofs of the Duval layout. It looks worse than I dreamed.
No, it's a little contrived, that's all.
You wouldn't excuse it from anyone else.
It would be good from anyone else. It's just that your standard is higher. Anyway, I didn't call you in about the Duval layout.
I didn't think so.
How about coming out to stay with us for the week? With Victor going off to Bristol, you're going to be lonely.
You've seen the paper.
Yes.
It's good of you, Maurice, but I'll manage.
Well, Laura would love you to come, and you know how the children feel about you.
Laura and I get on well, and I don't want to spoil that. She wouldn't appreciate having your protégé about for a whole week.
No, now, stop thinking of yourself as my protégé. I showed you the ropes, I made you into a fashion writer, but then you took it from there yourself. Now, circulation's gone up a solid 5% since we started carrying the Gloria Del Rey center spread.
You gave me a job that required all of my energy and attention when that's just what I needed. I can never thank you enough.
Well, then humor me and come along. I'll phone Laura and let her know.
I'd rather not, really. I want to come when it can be a holiday, not an escape.
You're sure?
Yes. Give Laura my love and a slap on the bottom for Mick and Jonathan from their Aunt Thelma.
All right, then. But Thelma, take care.
The cold black headline in the newspaper would seem to have nothing to do with high fashion Gloria Del Rey or with the woman who called herself Mrs. Victor Tasman. Even Victor, especially Victor, would not make any connection between the man mentioned in the newspaper headline and the woman who had become his own common law wife. Victor had simply accepted my rejection of a formal marriage ceremony. He had no way of knowing I was already married. Married to Mervyn Spate, condemned murderer who was reported today to have escaped from Broadmoor Asylum for the criminally insane. Glenda was out of the office when I returned. It was just as well. I needed to be alone. The thought that clouded my mind was, what if Victor should find out? Perhaps I should tell him. Perhaps he was in danger as well as I. I saw it out of the corner of my eye. A small pink page from Glenda's memo pad had blown off the desk onto the carpet. I picked it up. Miss Del Rey, while you were out, a man called. He left no name, but asked for a Mrs. Spate. He seemed quite positive he had the right number.
Hugo Bishop here. A trifle on the bored side today. But that shouldn't last. It seldom does here in London, you know. Always something irregular going on about. It shan't take me long to find it. Or the reverse. It's a hobby of mine, actually. People in trouble, that is. I share an office with a very regal Siamese cat and a middle-aged, rather conservative woman with an Oxford degree and a talent for embroidery. Mira Gorringe is her name. I prefer to call her Gory. Marvelous woman, with a flair for nosing out the fantastic, the incredible, and the macabre. Gory placed the files on my desk as soon as the early edition of the Standard hit the street. But I was taking a perverse delight in ignoring them and turned my total attention to cleaning out my favorite meerschaum.
That sort of thing should be done in the bathroom.
How many times have I told you that? Love me, love my pipe.
I should think you'd rather be putting your attention to a bit of business.
Such as what?
Spate is free.
Who?
Mervyn Spate. Found guilty but insane 2 years ago at the Central Criminal Court and committed to Broadmoor Asylum.
For murder?
A woman on a bomb site in Ludgate Hill.
Name of Joanna Martin.
You've been baiting me all along, I suppose.
The names of murder victims seem to stick in my mind. But I don't seem to think this means a job for me.
An escaped homicidal maniac isn't the least interesting person in the world. I should think you'd like to have a talk with Mervyn Spate.
You know where I might find him?
No, but if you can't find him, no one can. And there's his wife. She wouldn't make a bad starting point.
Gloria Del Rey. Now, that's the second file you placed on my desk.
If you want a new study for your personality under stress thesis, she should provide it.
I should prefer a graphic summing up to slogging through a folder of your copious notes.
With the way you're scattering hot ashes from that smelly monstrosity of yours, it'd be less of a fire hazard, at least.
Anyone tell you, you look a rare treat today, babe.
Really, Mr. Bishop, babe is hardly a suitable nomenclature for someone old enough to be your great-aunt.
Well, very well, Auntie. Give me the dope on Gloria Del Rey, formerly Mrs. Mervyn Spate.
Still Mrs. Spate, but now calling herself Mrs. Victor Tasman.
A new marriage isn't legal, then?
Can't be. She's never divorced Spate.
As I recall, Spate was an artist before he took up murder.
Thelma met him at art school. At the time of the murder, they'd been married 3 years. By then, Spate had become a professional painter with something of a reputation.
All smashed to bits in that one moment of violence in Ludgate Hill.
Quite.
Did Thelma Spate attend her husband's trial?
Faithfully, remaining the loyal wife throughout. Despite the fact that apparently the marriage wasn't a blissful one, Spate had too much temperament for his pretty young wife to handle.
Wherever do you come by your little crumbs and information, Gory?
One must learn the language of the sparrows. They sit on every windowsill.
Well, I'm more of a raven myself. So, with her husband put behind bars at Broadmoor, what did Thelma Spate do following the trial?
Left England for a bit to get away from the notoriety. Lived alone in Italy.
And met Victor Tasman?
Technical representative of a British-owned aircraft and allied products company.
Quite the opposite from the temperamental artistic type.
Precisely.
And Thelma Spate then returned to England as Thelma Tasman.
And became Gloria Del Rey, thanks to Maurice Gerald, editor-in-chief of Miller Group Publishing.
And how does he fit into the picture?
Friend in need, I should say. He first offered his assistance to the stricken young wife during the trial. Then immediately on her return to England, came forward with the job of fashion editor.
Why did Gerald do this, do you suppose?
Plainly felt sorry for her, I imagine. He's known as a generous man. Also, perhaps he sensed she had the makings of a crackerjack fashion writer, since that's what she's turned out to be. This room is 20 feet long and 16 feet wide, with at least a dozen sizable ashtrays strategically placed about. Need I say more?
No, but you probably will. It appears to me the prime question for conjecture at this point is, does Spate know?
Does Spate know what?
That Mrs. Spate is now calling herself Mrs. Tasman.
Then you're interested?
I don't know yet.
Well, if you decide you are, you'll find the files quite complete.
I frequently bless your morbid curiosity, Gory.
It appears Princess Ju Yi Xin would like an audience with you.
Ah, send her in. Hello, gorgeous. The Princess Ju Yi Xin paddled silently across the room, the light from the windows glinting in her great blue eyes. With one quick flash of smoky fur, she leapt onto the desk, settled on her haunches beside me, with a tail curled neatly around her chocolate feet. I blew my meerschaum back into life, and the cat and I together watched the curl of smoke with a quiet, idle fascination. And then I brought out the chess set. I stitched the pieces and set them on the board one by one. Thelma Spate, alias Mrs. Victor Tasman, alias Gloria Del Rey. The Queen in danger. Next, a white rook near the Queen. Maurice Gerald, the protector, at an equal distance from the Queen, a white knight. Victor Tasman, the constant lover, behind the Queen, directly behind, but at a greater distance. Mervyn Spate. Husband, murderer, madman. The Red King, enrobed in blood. With a red pawn laid beside the King. Joanna Martin, dead by the King's hand, and bloodied too. What do you think, my beauty? Time to place the sixth piece on the opposite side of the board, away from the others, but facing them. A white bishop, my own namesake, at a standstill and wondering where to begin.
There were yellow tulips in a bowl on the table, bright as agony in the sunshine. It seemed astonishing that color so brilliant should cast a shadow of mere gray on the tablecloth. But the shadow was there. Seven gray heads against the blue linen.
Gloria Del Rey works too hard.
She likes it that way.
I know.
Victor Tasman should talk, whose job is taking him off to Bristol for a whole bloody week.
I have no choice. And the sooner I go, the sooner I should be back.
What can I do to compete with a supercharger?
What is it, love? Is something troubling you?
No.
Lucky you. Have you seen the papers today?
Why? Why, no, I haven't. Is there some reason I should?
Velma, darling, you are tense. All of London will be, I should think. Seems a maniac escaped a loony bin.
Victor, I love you.
Well, then, for the thousandth time, marry me.
Not that today, Victor, please. Let's order lunch, shall we?
God save the Queen.
I decided to start exploring my interest in the Spate affair by comparing notes with my old chum, Freddy, Detective Inspector Frisnay of the New Scotland Yard. We met at one of my favorite spots, which wasn't one of Freddy's, a milk bar at the bottom of Charing Cross Road. You'd better find Spate quickly, don't you think, Freddy? I mean, the bloke might go and pop someone else off just to celebrate being on the outside. And where would you be?
Anywhere would be preferable to here, sitting with Hugo Bishop contemplating a milkshake. What are you having?
Oh, I rather fancy a strawberry shake and a ham sandwich. Seeing it'll come out of your expenses.
I'm off duty.
Oh, I hate to contradict you. But we're going to talk business.
Whose?
Yours.
Don't you ever talk about your own.
I haven't any of my own. My business is everybody else's.
All right. Only anything but Spate. I've had enough of him for one day.
Where are you looking for him?
No statement.
Well, we won't talk about Spate. We'll talk about Mrs. Spate.
She's out of town.
Out of town?
We checked her address.
What address?
19 Stapleton Crescent. Spate's been sending letters to her there ever since he's been in the asylum. We checked it out, but the woman who lives there is out of town.
Eve Jordan is out of town. Thelma Spate isn't.
Come again?
Eve Jordan lives at 19 Stapleton Crescent. She's Thelma Spate's best friend. Thelma used Eve's address for Spate's letters.
Why?
Why? Would you feel comfortable about a husband who was a convicted murderer and judged mad to boot?
You think Spate's escape puts his wife in danger?
Well, she evidently thinks so. That should be enough.
Tell me, Hugo, where do you come by all your information?
I live in close proximity to a sparrow.
Where would we find Thelma Spate, then? Hugo?
That shape is making my mouth water.
Oh, it's like suddenly you're shaved with, if you ask me. Don't see why all this electricity and chrome and chemical flavoring have to do with a simple rustic cow. Give me a good old timber-built, worm-eaten, honest-to-God pub any time.
You don't have to stay and humor me, Freddy. Go and have your beer if you'd like.
Oh, all right, Hugo. You win. A ham sandwich and a strawberry shake on the yard.
Thank you, Freddy. That's very kind of you.
And now let's have it. Where can we find Mrs. Mervyn Spate?
Yard would assign a man to Thelma Spate in the hope that she was the lure that would inevitably put Mervyn Spate back in the trap. Freddy and I parted company outside the milk bar, and I walked up toward Trafalgar Square. Dusk had fallen. A news vendor hawked papers on the corner. Maniac murderer at large. London at night. Where was Mervyn Spate this moment, I wondered. I thought over Scotland Yard's proposed strategy. This extremely risky business, exposing your queen that way. Lose her, and the match is all but lost. And this is no ordinary game. All possibilities must be weighed and measured. Thelma Spate Tasman is in a most precarious position. One false move could mean the game. And we are playing with her life.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, Queen in Danger. I'm Rod Serling, and this is The Zero Hour. There are detectives, and there are detectives. And then there's Hugo Bishop, connoisseur of crime. Item, maniac murderer at large. Mervyn Spate, convicted killer, has escaped from Broadmoor Asylum for the criminally insane. The preceding news brief was brought to Hugo Bishop's attention by his bird-like secretary and confidant, Vera Gorringe. That and the plight of Gloria Del Rey, renowned beauty editor of Venus magazine. In private life, she is Thelma Tasman, common law wife of industrial engineer Victor Tasman, who is currently away on business. Her employer, publishing mogul Maurice Gerald, too, is out of town, leaving this woman of many names alone in London and terrified by her own identity. The fact is, she has still another name. Spate. Mrs. Mervyn Spate. Queen in Danger will continue in a moment.
It was the first of the week's fashion shows I was scheduled to cover. I was alone, except for the jostling crowd around me, dividing their attention between the show about to begin in the main salon and the table bar set up here in the anteroom.
Hello, beautiful.
Rex!
You sound glad to see me.
I am. Built for the soccer field as you are, you can probably manage to make your way through this mob to get me a sherry.
Any little service I can render, though. Be right back.
Rex Willison was London's favorite fashion photographer. He was also a rat, a rake, a roué. I wouldn't rely on him for my life any more than I would thin ice. But he was big, with magnificent shoulders and a cheerful grin, and just the sort of company I needed at the moment.
Here you go, love.
Thank you, Rex. That's just what I needed.
Oh, for a moment, I relished the thought that I was just what you needed.
You are, but not quite in the way you're thinking.
What's wrong, beautiful? You look a bit down under.
Victor's gone away on business for a week.
Yeah. I wonder if I'll ever meet a girl who'll be miserable when I leave her for a week.
You wouldn't be interested in one like that.
You're right there, love. So, shall we? Looks like post time for the show horses.
Lights, music, and on the show. Number one, a tie silk day dress in Mediterranean blue by Jacques Dupois. Note the loose three-quarter length sleeves, designed for coolness on all occasions, and the softly draped neckline, eternally feminine.
Neat little filly, lad, and pretty footwork.
I feel Rex's solid masculine presence beside me, and somehow I'm safe. Safe for now.
Shoes made beautifully to match by Norman Lane, and the mischievous little hat by Michelson.
Later tonight, if I feel really afraid, I can telephone Victor. Just the sound of his voice over the phone will comfort me. Or I can spend the evening with Rex. He'll dine me if I ask him, and I could deal with the inference he'd draw from it later. For that matter, I needn't stay at my place at all this week. I could rent a room at some small hotel while Victor was away. Somewhere across the city, far away from the flat where Mervyn would never find me. Rex is flashing me his best grin, and I can manage a smile back. I needn't really be afraid. Of that I'm convinced. But still, I am afraid. I am.
The Tasman flat, where Thelma Spate lived out her new alliance with Victor Tasman, was round the corner from Queen Street in Thames Gardens. When I walked by there to take a look, I found my Scotland Yard confederate, Freddy Frisnay, checking with this man on the job.
No sign of Spate or Mrs. Either up to now.
You going to talk to her when she shows?
No.
Why not?
Well, she could be ready to aid and abet him, you know.
Not as I see it. Reason it out, Freddy. She goes abroad after the trial and comes back with a man who's her new husband, except for that little detail of the ceremony. Doesn't sound to me like she's ready to give Spade a hand. More likely she's worried what he's ready to give her.
Well, we can keep just as good a watch on her without knocking on her door.
And she hasn't knocked on yours yet.
What do you mean?
She hasn't asked for any police protection.
No, which shoots your theory.
Spade got himself out of Broadmoor for some reason. He found out his wife was living with another man, seems a good one to me, and I'm sane.
You wouldn't care to submit to a test of that fact, would you?
Freddy, my boy, as a matter of fact, I've just gotten a sudden crazy idea.
Do you want to share it?
Not till I see if it works. Just have to make a quick call to be sure my little sparrow is home on the nest.
Hello?
Gory?
Yes?
Did you send it?
Yes, it's there by now.
Do you mind staying in case there's a call?
I wouldn't miss it. This was my case to begin with, you know.
I know.
But I gather it's caught your interest.
A bit. At any rate, I've just gotten a notion, and it might keep me most of the night.
Dangerous, Mr. Bishop?
Yes. A slight risk of varicose veins. Ta-ta, Eddie.
As it turned out, I had to go back to my own flat. Rex, it seemed, engaged a sylph-like model for the evening's recreation. So, I took a taxi home to face my fear alone. What was my fear, exactly? It seemed I also had to name it. Mervyn had learned about Victor and me. He had managed to escape from Broadmoor for one reason, to kill me. Strangle me with that same hideous strength that had snuffed out the life of the woman on the bombed site in Ludgate Hill. But it wasn't the man I feared, or even death. It was the madness. The fear of encountering a deranged mind. And if that wasn't enough, I got into it with the cabbie, and he absolutely refused to take me to my door. He left me at the corner. Turned up the steps to the entrance of the flat, I became acutely aware of the presence of a man in the shadows of the doorway across the street. The flesh at the nape of my neck crawled. I quickened my step, hurried inside and closed the outer door. A moment later, I was inside my apartment, flattened against the door in the dark, frightened of what I might see if I turned on the light. Then the toe of my shoe touched something on the floor and I reached for the light switch. In the glow of the ceiling lamp, I saw the envelope, mute and white against the royal blue of the carpet. Three words were written boldly across the front of it. Mrs. Victor Tasman. A threatening note from Mervyn. That was all I could think of, although the handwriting on the envelope was unfamiliar. I slit the envelope open with my finger and took out the note. It was brief. All it said was, "If you need help, telephone CAR 2330. Ask for Bishop."
The flower grew against the sky, black-petaled, with a stem as thick as a tornado's rope. And where I viewed it in my cramped position against the broken wall. Somewhere here, among the rubble and the creeping tapestry of weeds, Joanna Martin had been found with the life throttled from her body and her blood congealed on a slab of stone that her skull had split against. And they had found Spate, too, lying in the half-choked cellar below the woman's body, still unconscious from his crashing fall. Twice since I'd come, the monotony of waiting and the strain of cramped leg muscles had nearly caused me to give up. I knew that my chances of success were worse than poor. But then, the thought would repeat itself in my mind. The thought that had brought me here to this infamous bomb site, Luckett Hill. It was a tired old saw, but nonetheless true. Often, a murderer did return to the scene of his crime.
Victor, is that you?
Thelma, what's wrong?
Nothing, darling. I'm sorry it's so late.
It's only 12. You sound odd. What is it?
No, Victor. Everything is all right. I just wanted to hear your voice and say goodnight.
I'm glad. Actually, I meant to phone you, but I've been talking my head off steadily for hours, trying to fix a deal.
Any luck, darling?
Not really sure. But never mind about business. I miss you, my love.
I caught myself only half listening. My eyes were focused on the door to the flat, and I was imagining Mervyn walking up to it, his hand on the knob, his brute strength forcing it open.
Darling?
I miss you too, Victor. Terribly.
There is something wrong.
I'm lonely for you, that's all. Please don't be away any longer than you have to.
You know, I really...
Your 3 minutes are up.
Operator, this is a private call.
I'm sorry. You booked 3 minutes. Shall I extend it?
Yes. No. Good night, Victor. Hurry back.
I'll telephone you in the morning, darling. Get a good night's sleep.
Victor, I'm... I found myself staring at the door. I don't know how long I sat there. I was not aware when my mind crossed the border dividing reason from obsession, from control to submission, plunging me into a wilderness of terror. It was no longer possible for me to believe that Mervyn would not come, or when he came, that he could not get in. I stared at the door and saw the knob turn, the door open, and Mervyn standing there, his eyes bright with unreason, his shabby figure slack, his hands hanging loose until he lifted them and came toward me.
Perhaps mute stones are infused with memory, like an unseen stain. Or else I was only diverting myself from the boredom of my vigil. In any event, I found my mind absorbed with images of that night 2 years ago, when Joanna Martin was slain. I saw the movement of her dress as she fled across the weed-strewn masonry, her stricken face as she turned back toward the man who picked his way through the rubble, moving to her with strong arms outstretched, eyes glinting with madness, the fierce look of fingers upon flesh, the violent squeezing out of the last vital breath of air. Of air, poor girl. Poor unfortunate madman. The vigil had made me morbid. The stones against my back had left me cold. And again I thought of giving up, leaving this place to its own brooding memories. I moved to ease the cramp in my legs and lifted my face to where the stars roofed the jagged gap between the broken walls. And there he was. A dark, hulking shape against the night sky, staring down at me with eyes void of all expression. Beyond the shadow of a doubt, it was Mervyn Spate. I remembered Gorey's question on the telephone. dangerous, Mr. Bishop. And now it was. I had crouched against this wall for more than 2 hours. My legs and back were cramped. My position alone had me at a disadvantage. Spade was standing almost directly over me, and he had already murdered once. He had little to lose by killing again.
Who are you?
My name is Bishop.
Police detective?
No.
What are you doing here?
I was waiting. Waiting for you.
You knew I would come here.
No. But I thought it was possible. This waste of bricks has been the most important place in your whole life.
If you're not a policeman, what is your interest in me?
Humanity interests me.
You want to observe the lunatic mind at work. You think I'm mad. But I'm not.
What's it like for you inside Broadmoor?
I have smokes, if that's what you're wondering. I'm on the block for privileged patients now. I can even shave with a razor.
But you're still locked up.
You can never see farther than the trees. Even when you know and remember and think about everything that's outside, all the people and things you used to know and love.
How do you spend your time in there?
They let me have paper and pencil. I make sketches. Sketches like these.
Spade abruptly tossed a small pad of paper down to me. I leafed through it. They were all sketches of a man's face. A face expressing violent hate and fear. The fine, drawn lines of the eyes and mouth conveyed a strain that transformed it into a face of abstract evil. I wondered if Spade meant it as a self-portrait.
Do you know that face?
It's the face of madness. Why do you spend all your time sketching only that?
I don't want to forget it.
And it's not meant as a self-portrait.
I told you, I'm not mad.
Why did you break out of Broadmoor, Spade? Because you wanted to see beyond the trees.
Give me back the sketches.
Oh, here you are, Spade.
You still think I'm mad?
He turned away then, and in a moment his dark, brooding form was no longer silhouetted against the sky. If I tried, I might follow and overpower him from behind. Or I could notify Freddy, the yard, his whereabouts. I did neither. At this point, I chose to let Spade go free.
I don't know when the phone stopped ringing or when I stopped screaming. I was still sitting by the phone, staring at the door, paralyzed by fear, when suddenly...
It's Bridget, Mrs. Tasman. Let me in. It's all right, Mrs. Tasman. I'm here to help you.
But how did you know
you
I need...
You called my number. You talked to my associate, Mrs. Gorringe.
I don't remember.
She told me you were very upset, very frightened. I thought perhaps Spade had come here.
I thought he had. I must have only imagined it.
Yes. Fear can play strange tricks.
I must have remembered your note.
Yes. That was why I sent it.
But I don't understand. Who are you? Why would you want to help me?
I want to help people in trouble for the opportunity it gives me of seeing life through other people's minds.
You take a morbid interest in personal tragedy.
Yes, interest. Morbid, no. Academic and constructive, I suppose. For two pins, you'd throw me out. Now that I've told you how I tick.
I think you're a strange man, Mr. Bishop, but I'm grateful for your offer of help, for whatever your reason. When I called your number, I was in a state of shock. The mere ringing of my phone had sent me into hysterics.
You thought it was your husband, that is, Mervyn Spate. It's true, you've never divorced Spate.
Yes. Somehow I couldn't. After he was sent away to the asylum, it seemed he needed me more than when we were together.
Well, I doubt it was Spate calling you tonight. It would have been about the time I was with him.
You've seen Mervyn?
I waited on the barn site in Luggett Hill. He came there as I thought he might.
How was he? I mean, how did he act?
As you would expect a hunted man to act.
Did he say anything?
He insisted he wasn't insane.
He kept insisting that all through the trial.
Well, criminals are always insisting they're innocent.
Did he say anything else?
Well, I asked him why he had broken out of Broadmoor. But he didn't answer.
I can tell you why, Mr. Bishop. There can be only one reason to kill me.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, Queen in Danger. I'm Rod Serling, and this is The Zero Hour.
This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
Been listening to The Zero Hour, a presentation of the Mutual Broadcasting System in association with Hollywood Radio Theater, heard every weekday at this time. Rod Serling is your host. Zero Hour is produced and directed by Elliot Lewis. The Hollywood Radio Theater theme was played by Ferranti and Teicher and is now available on United Artists Records and Tapes. Hugh Douglas speaking. Tune in tomorrow and once again,
rest your eyes and listen here
to The Zero Hour.
Mutual, your news and sports radio network.